स्वभाव चिन्मयानन्दं कृपापूर्णं जगत्पतिं हरिषड्वर्गजेतारं नित्यानन्दगुरुं भजे स्वभाव चिन्मयानन्दं।
All right, I'll answer few questions which can really add to some more clicks. Somebody very intelligent, just empty card. Swamiji, could you please provide an insight on relationship between the person's horoscopes and karma? Even though from time immemorial, the so-called logical people and atheists were abusing, disrespecting the traditional astrology, secretly they were always consulting astrologers. Even though many people try to abuse or disrespect, the science still holds its power, its influence on human beings. In India, the report says 93% of the people read or study their horoscopes regularly before taking any big decisions, not just marriage, before taking any big decisions. Surely there is a science behind it, even though, as usual, anything which expands certain limit, goes beyond certain limit, will lose its originality, will start getting diluted. There was little dilution in this science also, but that does not mean the science itself is a lie. Understand this one example, then you will be able to understand, connect with the astrology, the science of astrology. It's like for one moment in camera, when the cover moves, whatever was outside gets printed on the film. Then you can develop that film, it will become photograph. Second time, you can't use that same film. What first moment, what gets recorded, only that will be there in the film. Same way, the moment you come out, the moment your consciousness enters into the body, the energy level of the cosmos gets printed in that consciousness. Your inner space gets a print of the cosmic energy level based on the time of the birth and the position of the 9 major energy centers. I wanted one more understanding to be internalized by you all. The astronomical planets are not astrological planet energies. Even though number may be same, the astrological planets are energies. For example, planet Earth is here. Maybe I can use the paper to draw and show you. This understanding will really help. planet Earth is here. This is Sun. Different grahas are there. Please visualize this as eccentric circles and this as some planets. Okay. This is Sun. When we say here in our temple, if you see, there will be 9 planetary energies. Statue deities will be there. They will be worshipping. When we say Sani Graha, that is not exactly Saturn. Consider this as a Saturn. A particular energy of pull and push is there always between the grahas. The energy which comes out of the Saturn does not completely come and influence the planet Earth. In between, something will be added, something will be deleted. Different clash, energy clash will be there. For example, 100 unit push energy comes from the Saturn, and if 20 unit pulling energy comes from the Buddha, naturally it will be neutralized. It will become 80. And suddenly here you will see Shukra may add 30 unit. Then it will become 110. By the time it reaches the planet Earth, it may get deviated for some time. Then it may come down to 80 or 50. Whatever finally reaches, that is what we call Sunny, Saturn energy. Understand? It's a very subtle science. The same Saturn will not have same influence over planet Earth continuously. If he moves, the total calculation of the pull or push will differ. If he move, even sometime I have seen, within 12 days, the whole energy will be different. Whole energy will be different. If the astronomical planets and astrological planets are same, then the energy difference will not be there. But it is not same. It is not same. It is the totality of the energy reaches to the planet Earth. Maybe when we say Saturn, the major influence in that energy flow was from Saturn. When we say Buddha, it is not that only Buddha is radiating. That energy which came out of Buddha, by the time it reaches the planet Earth, goes through some 5-6 alteration. So many influences gets added and deleted. Then the energy reaches the planet Earth. The different energy positions clearly decides the cosmic energy level during your birth, during the time of the birth. Based on that, we will be able to easily predict the course of your life. Understand? Not exact incidents. Exact, if somebody claims they can predict exact incidents, and I have seen all foolish ads in the newspaper, 3 days your problem will be solved. I'm really surprised. I thought of anyhow. I don't think incidents themselves can be predicted. Only a course of kind of a rough course only can be predicted. Incidents are too minute details, and you do have a freedom. Understand? Even if a minute incidents like which chair you will sit, if that can be predicted, you don't have a freedom. You don't have a freedom. You do have a freedom, whether you can, you have a freedom to decide whether to sit here or not, or listen here or not, or understand or not. All those things, you have a freedom. Maybe the major actions, major course, like whether you will become enlightened or not, maybe those things can be predicted. But the small decision, only principles can be predicted, not the policies. Policies, you have an individual freedom. Having an idea about horoscope, your own horoscope, will give you many times intelligence and acceptance to decide about your life. Intelligence to make decision, acceptance about the inevitable things. So according to me, a seeker should have little bit basic intelligence about their own horoscope. Better to read some books and have an idea than going to some person who is new, who doesn't know. In those days, fortunately, we had family astrologers. I know. My own family had an astrologer who is very precise, who is very... One more thing. If that guy is a family astrologer who knows completely your family, then he can interpret the energy flows. He can easily interpret and guide you. He can be a counselor also, personal counselor also. We had a fortune of having that kind of a astrologer who is professional, who is an experienced astrologer, who knows the signs, above all, knows the family well. So, easily he can do the job of counseling. At least, whatever I heard from my parents, not even once his prediction failed. His prediction failed. It's a very surprising. His only one prediction failed, that he predicted that I will die at the age of 18. I took sannyas. That is the only thing. failed. Of course, sannyas is practically rebirth. Otherwise, such a precise knowledge. So try to read one or two books. It will really give you an opening and glimpse, and it will be really exciting. When I started studying, it was very exciting. You can play a lot with it, because there is the astrological sutras actually encourage your visualization and power to connect things. It really helps you. You mentioned that you had 72 topics when you... Oh, there's a question from yesterday. Somebody is asking, would it be possible to name all the 72 topics you wanted to discuss only in some book? Somebody is asking about food. We don't know who has touched the raw fruits, vegetables between the harvest and the shop. Should we not eat salads made from store-bought vegetables? Does washing purify them, or is cooking is the best way? Washing and energizing. You see, offering it to the deities are nothing but purifying process. That purifies the food completely. Offering it as a nivedya, or offering it to the divine, then eating will really purify and change the very quality of the food, very energy of the food. Still, even I personally tried this experiment. I told some of the people who make the laddus in Tirupati, some of them are our devotees. I told them to separate few pieces before it goes to offering. And after it goes to offering and comes back, really I tell you, honestly, I have tried at least 2-3 times. Surely taste is different. I don't know what goes on in the Garbha Mandir. what Venkateshwara does, but the quality, the taste is totally different. I can very clearly tell. The taste is different. Understand? Surely, energizing does a big job, even though logically this is very difficult to relate. See, till the Dr. Emoto, Japanese scientist, till he proved the power of our thoughts over the water, we can't imagine in 15 minutes you can pollute water. You don't need anything else except your mind to pollute water. So just like air pollution, water pollution, we should say now conscious pollution. He proved the consciousness, the world can be polluted by the ordinary mental thoughts. So power of the mind over the matter is proved by Emoto. Not once, 300 different experiments, and every experiment says, proves the power of the mind over the matter. I think it is a, whether we believe it or not, the ceremonies like a purifying or offering and all, that's a big job. Somebody is asking, can you please give some guideline on raising children, as there is no Gurukul system in this country. We don't have Gurukul, but we already started the weekend classes. I initiated the class, first class I myself conducted. For half an hour I had the patience to sit with them. Sit with the kids. Because half an hour they were shy. After that they opened up, then I decided that I can't sit anymore with them. As long as they were shy, I was able to sit with them. The moment I saw they were now opened up and now they are ready, I said, now class ends, please go. Anyhow, but we do have regular classes. This weekend we were not able to have because of the weekend workshop. But from next weekend, we do have regular classes. It will be happening. Bring them, surely we will at least do the damage control. We may not be able to bring them up as we want, at least we will do the damage control. What is the trick to get rid of fantasy on childhood front and keep current relationship happy? I tell you a very simple trick. Meet that same childhood friend now for 2-3 days, it will disappear. Really? The fantasy remains as fantasy because you did not see the reality. Just see that same, see, in the childhood, not only he becomes your fantasy, you would have become fantasy for many persons. Because they do not have the real idea about you now. See, in those, at the, in a childhood, he was also, because he was just expressing the joy and ecstasy, he made a deep impression in you. Because you are expressing the excitement and joy, you made a deep impression on the other person, on so many persons. Now, if you see the same person, you will understand, are the same dull fellow like me. And if they meet you, they will realize, are the same fool. There is nothing to be fantasizing. There is nothing worthy of fantasies in that person. Suddenly you will see the reality and the childhood fantasy will disappear. That is why I always tell people, it is very nice to attend alumni meetings if you are not enlightened. If you are not enlightened, good to attend alumni meetings. Alumni means where the colleges gather, where the childhood friends gather to meet once in a while. So, this is the best technique. Go and see that once or twice, then all your fantasies will disappear. You will come to reality. Should we avoid group meditation with an unenlightened leader? I can say, if the technique is from enlightened being, then it won't do big harm. But if the technique also from an unenlightened person, if the unenlightened person tries to add or deletes, if he starts commenting, then please avoid. Please avoid. What about yoga training, you are asking? Same with yoga. The system is from enlightened consciousness. Have it. The system is not from enlightened consciousness. If the person is adding or deleting or doing his own masala job, then relax. I have tears of revelation and bliss when I am in your presence. You have suddenly changed my junky iron ladder into a golden one, which will never rust. I have cried with joy with numerous clicks you offered in the last 8 days of your discourses, especially the one which attempts to clarify the reality that everyone and everything is extension of one another. Yesterday, with the same pool of love overflowing in my heart, I gave you a hug after taking the blessings from you. And this act of mine was brought to my attention as being arrogant. See, it was not arrogant. If I hug people, it'll not be a problem. If people start giving a tight hug, just imagine 400 people giving me a tight bear hug. For you, I'm the only one person hugging. If you imagine 400 people giving me a tight bear hug, and especially this is the only chance they get to come near me. So nobody misses the chance. And moreover, I don't know whether there is a spiritual superstition going around. If you squeeze more, you will get more energy. That is the reason we tell people, please, you do not squeeze. Swamiji will hug you, but you do not squeeze. Actually, if you see the early devotees, I would have allowed them also to hug, because they will not squeeze, they know. But the new persons, I really tell them, please, I'll hug you. You can just have your hands, but do not just use the chance. That is the reason we tell. And nothing else. That's the reason. There is no other disgrace or disrespect or anything. What you have done is not wrong. But when too many people do, physically, not only that, during energy darshan, body is very subtle. That is the reason we tell people, please, you be little careful. That's all. There is nothing. No other technical reason. It is just a simple social reason. In India, what all people do, you don't know. No, really, now, just before coming to this trip, I went to inaugurate one of our ashram in Namakkal. One guy came and he just literally bit my feet, my finger. And the toes he bit, and there was even little blood. And later on, people asked him, "Arey, why did you do that?" I also asked him, "Why did you do this?" He said, "Swamiji, you will always remember me." Oh God! That day, something like 22,000 people had darshan. If all 22,000 try that, I should remember them. I think nobody can remember me, or I can't remember. So, and another one, big danger, that is the state in the first list of HIV infection. Anyhow, there was no problem. We took care that neither that person was infected, and then I had to go through all the basic medical checkup completely. To take care and ensure and all this unnecessary headache. See, we had a first aid immediately, then I had to take care of anyhow. Medical care and all those things are also secondary. But it at least stops half an hour, 1 hour work. Half an hour, 1 hour, next darshan. So that's the reason we tell people that please try to be a little practical. Same as in India, for respect for gods and the gods to be, it would be great that the temple carpets
please train him regularly. Oh God, that's great. You are telling all the temples should be carpeted. Understand? In this country, the carpeting is possible. I don't think in India it is possible. India, all the temples are granited. And you know, these are just ordinary things. You can, maybe you can talk to the Indian government and tell them to do Master, just a note, born again and again and again, every time I think this is the ultimate, you give another birth chance. Every second ongoing process when I am in your presence or absence. I was playing pool yesterday. After Nitya Dhyan, which was intense, saw light after darshan, big explosion, I felt sleepy, like no other sleep, like experienced before. I almost did not make it home, felt sleep. 3 times on the road driving. I do not know how I made it home safe and alive. Drove sleeping. I slept night day till 4 p.m. today. Oh God. Then it is not sleep. Light flooding my body kept me calm and deeply mesmerized in sleep. Wonderful. This is not sleep. You can say it's a glimpse of Turiya. In the east, it's a wonderful question. In the West, most seekers of truth have thought the channeled information published by many New Age leaders to be path to enlightenment. As decades go by, seekers learn tens of meditations and healing styles with more and more phobias and self-doubts as well. In the East, the self is put in jail of sin and shame, are controlled by half-gurus that use magic to gather masses. But you in a very short time shown the breakdown of phobias and religions. Would you speak to these 3 ways people take as seekers and teachers? Wonderful. First thing, nobody is responsible. Neither the gurus who are channeling some ideas and writing, the New Age gurus, neither the Western New Age gurus who bring out channeled books, nor the Indian gurus, the half gurus, what you say, I don't want to say full gurus, half gurus, neither of them are responsible for our thing. Understand? If you are waiting to be cheated, you will feel connected only the person who is interested in cheating you. You are inviting them. It's not that they are inviting you. You are inviting them in your life. One thing, I always tell people, take up only if something is straight, open, based on, supported by the tradition, supported by thousands of years of knowledge. We call it apta pramana. The great scriptures like Upanishads, foolproof, time tested. When there is no support or the reference or the base principles from those scriptures, then please be aware and avoid, because many times people, when they get into delirium and fever, what they write, that becomes holy scriptures. No, really. They go into delirium and something they come out and whatever they spell out or write, and that becomes holy scripture and leads the whole world into deliritic state. Delirious state. I can only give this one scale. Maybe this can guide you. That technique or that person, after you come in contact with that person, initial introduction or initial exposure, does it add intelligence, awareness and bliss to you? If these 3 qualities, even 1 quality increases in you, go behind that person. Surely you will be helped. Or in these 3,
If you are not growing in these three, forget about him. Even if he brings fortune and wealth in your life, it will only be danger for you. It will only be danger for you. Even if he brings fortune or wealth in your life, it will be like a yakshas part. I'll tell this small story on yakshas part. I love to tell this story. Understand? One guy, one barber, every day he will go and shave the face of the king and receive his salary, one gold coin, and come back. King will be waiting to see him just because of the joy this barber radiates. This guy is fully contented guy. Never asked any favor to the king. See, shaving is a practically personal service. Means every day he is touching the king. So when you are in such a close proximity, naturally you can take advantage of the nearness. But he never asked anything, radiating contentment, just fulfillment. Naturally, if you want to impress a politician, be fulfilled, he will be impressed by you. I tell you, no. These are all few things. If you want to impress a poor idiot, show your wealth, he will be impressed. If you want to impress fool, show your knowledge, he will be impressed. If you want to impress a politician, show your contentment, he will be impressed. Because that is what he does not have. He has everything. He has enough cunningness, enough display, enough of all qualities. You can't display anything and attract attention of politician or inspire, influence him. You can impress him if you show your contentment, fulfillment. That is the way Buddha influenced all the politicians of India. During Buddha's time, there was not a single guy, single king who did not become Buddhist. Who did not become Buddhist. Practically 90% of the India became Buddhist because of the contentment he was radiating, and he was just showering or expressing through his being. The whole group of politicians became his disciples. So this guy, for him, this barber is almost like a little Buddha. Every morning he feels seeing him is an auspicious thing. He will be waiting to see. And never ever that barber asked for pay raise. Suddenly, 1 week continuously, the barber's face was not so contented, so peaceful, so fulfilled. First thing the king asked is, did you get the golden jar from Yaksha? The barber was shocked. He said, yes sir, how do you know? Then king tells the story. Listen here. I'll tell you the story, what the yaksha would have done. You would have been walking under that particular banyan tree. Some of these banyan trees are the place where gods and yakshas both come and sit. And you would have heard the voice, do you need money? Gold jar filled with golden coins. Yakshas, the barber said, yes sir. Did that voice show you a particular place below the tree and ask you to dig? He said, yes sir. When you dig, you saw the big jar almost full. He said, yes sir. Then what did you do? Then he said, now I'll tell you the story, what I did. I took the jar to the house. I saw it's almost full. Only few coins are needed to fill it. So I thought one day I will not spend the coin which I took from you as a salary. I put it in that jar. Just I wanted to have a jar filled with golden coins. Now some 10-15 coins are less. So I put the coin in that. That day we both of us managed from our savings, whatever we had. Same way, for few more days, we just put the coins. How many days I put the coins? Again, I see the jar is not full. There is little emptiness. What to do? Suddenly, I saw my wife has become very angry with me because I am not allowing her to use the money, and my kids are angry with me.
Now I am caught in the rut. Neither one side my desire to have a full jar of gold coins. The other side, I have to fulfill my regular responsibilities. Then king said, understand, just now go and tell that Yaksha, please take your jar back and get rid of it. I also had the jar once and I am not returned the jar. That is why I am king. Understand? That is why I am king. You return the jar and be as a old person. I love, I envy your status. I envy your state. That is why every day morning I wait to see you. Somehow I neither had maturity and now it is too late to return. Now it is too late to return. One guy, one liner, one guy says, by the time I found out I have nothing to write, I have started writing books. After some time suddenly I found out I am nothing to write, I am not that intelligent to write books. The other guy asked, did you stop? No, by now I have become too famous. So by the time the king gets the clarity, he has to return the jar, only then he will be contented. The kingdom is created, he is already in the rut, he can't come out, he can't escape. That is the one worst thing. You can't get out of that rut. You are caught once for all over. I have seen. At least in India, many politicians at some time, some way, by mistake or by accident, when they see some enlightened beings, something clicks in them also. Because of their experience and feeling of the unfulfillment, something clicks in them. I myself have seen personally, when I tell them, Are, then why don't you start turning your life into a new direction? He says, no Swamiji, now if I step down, either I will be put in prison or killed. I have to play this game till I die. Because I created already enough of enemies. Already I created enough of enemies and enmity. Whoever is unfulfilled or dissatisfied when I was in the power is waiting. Now I have to at least maintain a certain level of power, at least I will not be taken revenge. I cannot just completely quit and retire. The moment I retire, I will be finished. So it's like a game. King says, yes, now it is too late to return. Please, you don't get caught in this mess. And king says, very beautiful word. Your head is the Yaksha's golden pot. How much you put, it will never be filled. Understand? How much you put, it will never be filled. Go and return to the Yaksha, your head. The unfulfillment. See, anything you put in your head, you will see. It will take it for granted. Anything. The moment you have it, the head will take it for granted. When you came to this country, you would have had the list of having one house, one car, one family, and certain bank balance. All that would have happened in 3-4 years. But now, you don't celebrate about, you achieved that goal. You took it for granted. And now the Yaksha's head is working. The Yaksha's part is working. I tell you, at least return the head. You don't have to return the part, but return the head. Person who is filled with that kind of greed will naturally be suffering with Yaksha's part. What is the key to discipline in spiritual practice? Is it just Americans who have this problem of lack of discipline? No. I don't, as far as discipline and immorality concern, it is a universal. It is not Easterner or Westerner. There is a very beautiful line from Patanjali. He says, after describing the Yama, the basic understandings of the life, Ahimsa, non-violence, Satya, truth, Asteya, non-stealing, Aparigraha,
not possessing more than what you need. Again, if you are possessing more than what you need, you are stealing. Just yesterday I read a statistics. In this country, 30 million people are undernourished and 30 million people are suffering with obesity. Means too much obesity. Means the obese people have eaten the undernourished people food. Now I was really surprised to see the same number. Same number, that's what. When you have more than what you need, the aparigraha, you are stealing. It's asteya. Non-possessiveness and above all, the brahmacharya means behaving decently, having relationship only based on love. Maybe I can translate the word brahmacharya into a... Yesterday I was struggling to translate that word. This can be a wonderful translation. Having relationship only based on love, not based on anything else, can be that. Because a person who is having physical relationship only based on love, even when he has relationship, he will not have the side effects of the immorality. Side effects of or dangers of the anything else. He will have the more deeper, settled, balanced life. Anyhow, when Patanjali describes all these great five vows, he makes a statement, sarvabhaumya vrataha. Very beautiful statement, let me translate. These understandings are for the whole world forever. Bhashyakara says, like a morality is universal, immorality is also universal. Do not think in the West immorality is more or in the East immorality is more, nothing like that. Both always same. And don't think now only it has become more and in those days it was less. No. In those days there was no CNN or website. Now we have, that's all. I don't think there is any other difference because 5,000 years ago in Harappan culture, if you read their stone writings, whatever they carve in the stone, those words, it feels like a modern day morning newspaper, you know, the newspaper editorial. It says, nowadays kids are not respecting the parents, though there is no morality in the place, and people are living on their own, and nobody is responding, nobody is respecting the tradition and spirituality. These are all the words written in that stone. Means 5,000 years ago the same problem was there. So relax. It's a immorality is universal and eternal. Same way, vratam, morality, sarva, niyama and niyamas are also universal and eternal. There's no such thing as West or East or those days or nowadays. See, the those days concept is actually a fantasy. When you were young, everything was looking great because you are innocent. Not because everything was great. Because you were innocent. Either you are not aware of what was happening around you, or you are not that cunning to judge everything around you. These two reasons. You are not informed, and you are not that cunning or judgmental, continuously judging everybody. Now the change has happened in you, not in the society. That is same drama only is going on. There's somebody, personal question. I'm not even able to read the name. That person can ask. Energy session can ask. What is your view about organ donation? Now I wanted to put this in record. Organ donation is no way disturbing your enlightenment or your spiritual growth. Many people ask me, after somebody dies, If the organs are donated, will that soul have enlightenment or moksha? Will it not disturb the flow of life? Nothing, no way it will be disturbed. You are not going to wait and see whether your eye, everything is properly burnt or properly buried. See the greed, even after a death, is not leaving. The possessiveness over the body, even after a death, it is not leaving. No way it will affect your further journey. Actually, in three chana, you take the next body. You will not even be attending your funeral. Understand, by that time you will be attending your birthday celebration somewhere. So you will not even be there for your funeral. So I completely acknowledge, welcome, encourage any organ donation. I wanted this to be on record for our devotees, at least for our tradition. There was a lot of discussion. Even the other day I was reading some article in some magazines and books related to Hinduism. Fools were saying that the karma of that person who donates the organ will go to the new person, nothing. Karma is not in your head. Karma is in the system which is operating the head. You are donating only hardware, not software. If an hardware of some computer is taken and fixed in you, you will not have the same software or memory in this new computer. So only if the software is transmitted, you will have the same memory. Mind is software, body is hardware. Donating hardware or the spare parts of the hardware will no way transmit the software. No way transmit the karmas. Karmas are related to software. So be very clear about it. Here is again some personal question. Can I ask in the energy darshan? Somebody has put a question about the child abuse and he has given a shocking statistics. I don't know from where the person got the statistics, like a in US over 60% of girls sexually abused before 18 and something like that. Different statistics, maybe, I don't know, different region or something. This problem, I can tell you, because of the pornography, too much of unnecessary fantasies have been put inside the head. If that is banned, the problem will disappear. I actually studied this problem. In India, it is practically nil. Only in the cities. Cities are no more part of India. I don't say cities are India. Cities are no more India. It is a... Anyhow, let us not talk about it. And only in cities I am hearing all this. In villages, they don't even have an idea about this. Even idea about this. I think the wrong fantasies and ideas going inside. I can tell you one more thing. If the depth of relationship can be created, the man will have the fulfillment. One nice thing, in India, even if you fight, they will stay together till the end just for fighting. No, wonderful. What else? You see, at least you will not have a loneliness. You will have somebody to fight with. See, that is the only way they know how to relate. That's all. That is okay. No, really. It's not that the people who fight, it's not that couples, just because they are fighting with each other, they can be separated. No, if they stay even few days separately, they miss the fight. They miss the fight. So I tell you, the depth of relationship really brings a kind of fulfillment, even if it was fighting based. So I really feel there is a strong reason why our masters decided not to allow divorce as a social custom. Even if there was a fight, there was a disrespect on both sides, the divorce was never allowed, and that was never a custom or part of life. I have seen even in the families in which I was born and brought up, the husband and wife, not only they will not sleep in same room, they will not even talk to each other, they wouldn't have slept in the same room for 20-30 years, but they will not go for a divorce. They may, even while they crash, they will only give a look. But husband will never bother to bring the sari and leave it in the room, or he will never miss to bring the money and put it in the kitchen, and wife will never miss to keep the food on the table. At least there is something. It goes on. It goes on. So sometime I can say that kind of a, even that kind of relationship brings a sort of a fulfillment, and there is no loneliness, you see. You don't end up in the extreme loneliness. I can say the extreme loneliness and all is one reason why we start perverting or diverting our love. Let's enter into the sutra. Devi, enter etheric presence, pervading far above and below your form. This is a Nitya Sutra. Means you are supposed to internalize and practice whole day, morning till night. Let me explain exactly the word etheric, that is the key word here. Understand, you are not just the body as you think. It is only one part of you. Physical body made out of flesh and bones is one part of you. There is a second layer. The air which you inhale and exhale, understand? The prana which goes inside and comes out, that is the second layer, second part of your body. To kill somebody, you don't have to even poison the body. If you are just your body, if you are to be killed, your poison has to be added inside your body. But if poison is added, poisonous gas is added even in the room, the person will die. Means your boundary is not just the skin. You are not ending where your skin ends. The pranic layer is like a, maybe if you inhale and exhale deeply, from which distance you can smell. For example, you can smell, some people may be able to smell any smell which is there 6 feet distance. For some people they can smell even 20 feet. For some people, fortunately, who kept the nose very sharp in the young age, if you are not suppressed, your nose will be very sharp. Your sense of smell will be very sharp. They can smell even 70-80 feet. The distance you can smell is your pranic layer. That area, yeah, if it is polluted or corrupted, directly you will be affected. Then you may think, if my nose is too sharp, then I have to maintain too much area. Understand? Pollution, even if you don't maintain, it is going to affect the health. If your nose is sharp, at least you will know you are inhaling polluted air. You are inhaling polluted air. Nothing else. The distance you can smell will be your pranic layer. Prana sharira. Understand? In the physical layer, the distance between two persons is more. In the prana sarira, many of our prana sariras are overlapping. Means the distance between two persons is less. That is why sometime when you sit next to somebody, you will feel uncomfortable. With somebody, you will feel very relaxed, very restful. In the meditation class, I have seen, before meditation, they will not feel any uncomfort to sit next to somebody. But after meditation, because the sensitivity has grown, they will just move out of that person. Move out of that person. Because the, now they can feel the pranic layer. Now the boundary is overlapping. Animals are very conscious and very intelligent about the pranic layer. You can see in the zoos, if the other animal enters the pranic layer, that's enough. This girl will, he'll be showing the face. And early morning, if you see Indian streets, I've seen the dogs will go around and ensure their pranic layer is protected by pissing in the light bulbs. And they'll go around and ensure that their pranic layer is, their boundaries are protected. Anybody who enters inside the boundary itself is enough, this fellow will get ready for fight. Without moving away, when you close your eyes, is mental layer. For example, if you close your eyes and able to visualize this hall in one single frame of mind, in one single visualization, if you are able to visualize this hall, this is the distance of your mental layer. For example, if you have to visualize the parking lot, you may have to leave this frame and go there. You may have to unclutch from this frame and visualize the parking lot. Kids can visualize at least 10 times more space than you. That is why many questions they ask, you are not able to answer. Understand? If you are in an open space, if you are in front of an ocean or a vast hilly region, how much area you can visualize? You may be able to visualize some 30 degree vision. This much area only you will be able to visualize in one picture, in your heart, in your inner space. If you have to visualize the other side, you have to move this out only as a second thought or as a second visualization only you can visualize. But with the kids, they can easily visualize 120 degree. 120 degree, and especially the child, kids who doesn't go to school, who are not abused by the so-called verbal-based, word-based education system, logic-based education system. Of course, I can't say it's a Western, because now Eastern, Western, everywhere, logic-based education system. The kids who are not abused, abused by the logic-based education system, they will have 360-degree visualization. Understand? When I talk about my first experience, I talk about this only. I was able to visualize, I opened up to the visualization of 360-degree. Kids, till you finish them making like you, till you give birth to your software into them, when you give birth only to hardware, your hardware in them. Only genetically they are affected. When you put your education system in them, you affected them mentally also. You affected them mentally too. Till they are affected mentally, till they are abused by the, I wanted to use this word again and again, by the logic based education, which is the worst damage done to the human mind. When the logic based education system is given, they lose the ability of visualization, seeing things under one visualization. The creativity or innovation is lost. I tell you, along with the verbal, word-based or the logic-based education, if your kids can do little meditation or this carving, anything directly done by using the hand, carving or painting or completely involving eyes and the hands, they can bring the visualization energy back, efficiency back to their system. If that can be done, it will really take care without abusing the kids. Anyhow, mental layer means the area you are able to visualize without any need to move away. For example, If you are visualizing now, able to visualize now this whole hall, one more important thing. Most of you may not even be able to visualize this whole hall at a time. Once you, even the whole hall, if you see, you will see first people, then you will see the screen. Even for this hall, you may need 2-3 movement. The area which you are able to visualize without moving is the mental layer boundary. Mental layer boundary. One more important thing. Like if Annamaya Kosha has to be killed, poisoning Annamaya Kosha is needed. Through Pranamaya corruption, poisoning the, polluting the air is needed. In the mental layer, anybody who is inside that mental layer, his ideas will go into your system without your editing. That's an important thing. So, corrupting ideas are put in your head. That is why whatever ad goes on in the television enters your head. Because that time, that becomes your mental layer. That becomes part of your mental layer. Hardly 10% you logically analyze the news which is read out to you in the TV or the informations which are told to you through the TV. Because in the TV, in 10 minutes, almost you become part of that mental layer. That becomes part of your mental layer. That is why 90% of the words and ideas which is told through you, told to you through the TV, just goes inside. Corrupting 2-3 TV channels is enough to pollute the whole mental setup of particular country, certain country. Fourth layer, very important, etheric layer. Understand? Mahadeva talks about the fourth layer here, means layer of emotions, sentiments. Here the boundary will be bigger. Here the boundary will be even between USA to India. If your relatives are there in India, the distance is too much. Even if they are there, if they are sick, the suffering will be there for you. If somebody dies, the suffering will be there for you. The etheric layer is too big. Understand? Physical layer is only 6 feet. Your skin is the boundary. Pranic layer is the area up to the, you can smell. Up to the area you can smell is the pranic layer, boundary. Mental layer is the area you are able to visualize in one frame, one visualization. That is mental layer. Etheric layer is based on emotional connection. It does not have boundary. Does not have boundary. It is only based on the love or emotional connection you have with people. The feeling you have with people. The connection you have with people. An important thing you need to understand about the feeling or the connection you carry with the people. Even unconsciously it affects you. Even if you don't know they are sick, suddenly you will be low. Why you don't know? Then you will get the telephone call, they are sick. When you are really connected, even without logic, without knowingly, even if you are not informed through your, to your conscious mind, your unconscious will start suffering. Mahadeva says, start feeling the etheric presence. Understand? When you start feeling the etheric presence of you, means where all your energy is invested, all your emotional connections are like your energy investments, you can easily unclutch yourself from the sufferings. If you can find out all the etheric presence connections, your etheric layer connections, you can easily unclutch and enter into the enlightenment or the energy place, energy plane, where there is no
bondage, where there is no disturbance. If food poison happens, your annam, the physical plane, can be corrupted. If the air pollution happens, your pranamaya kosha can be disturbed. If a thought pollution happens, your manomaya kosha can be disturbed. If emotional ideology pollution happens, your etheric layer can be disturbed. Understand? Somebody can be tortured or prisoned. Here you will be suffering without even you directly getting involved with it. You can be tortured through remote control way. That is what is etheric layer is all about. Many times I have seen people feel etherically connected, means emotionally connected. Maybe the word etheric is too mysterious or mystical. If you are emotionally connected to the people who are back in your home, or if you are emotionally connected to people, some group of some religion, some group or some language, whenever some problem comes for them, you are here suffering. I have seen people suffer for no reason. I am all for serving lovingly and compassionately. If a tsunami hits, serve compassionately, nothing wrong. But don't start suffering. People think only by suffering you can serve. No, if you are suffering, you will not have energy to serve. You will not have energy to serve. Stop suffering. Have empathy. Empathy means feeling they are suffering and immediately working to remove it. Sympathy means suffering along with them. Empathy means working to remove their suffering. You are not supposed to suffer with them. I have seen. If Tamilians suffer there, here the Tamilians feel suffering. If the Hindus suffer there, here Hindus feel suffering. Somewhere if Muslims are suffering, here the Muslims will suffer. If you have etheric connection, emotional bondage, you invite, you accept, you are waiting for more and more suffering. Mahadeva says, feel your etheric presence with whom all you feel connected. Just for 10 days, try this technique. Feel you are present to all the people with whom you are feelingly connected. You are emotionally connected. Feel like a light beam in the form of a big light. You are connected to all the people with whom you emotionally feel connected. For example, if your parents are there in India, and if mostly none of you feel connected emotionally, if at all you feel emotionally connected, just visualize continuously. Your body is huge enough to accommodate the whole India inside, and they are there inside you. It may look very funny, but in 10 days, you will have so many new revelations. Understand? So many new revelations. How you imbibe, bring, invite new unnecessary sufferings. When you feel connected to them, even if they are not suffering, if they are going through some incident which you think is suffering, you will create suffering for you. Many times, they will be completely free, relaxed, resting. But what you think is suffering, if they go through, what you will do? You will feel the suffering and you will create suffering for them by forcing it on them. No, 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 this cannot happen to you. We do same thing in the name of love. I call that as a loving torture. Now I go through many times from disciples. Especially when they feed, they think if I eat more, they will get more punya. Based on my weight, they will get more punya. I don't know then what will happen to me. See, the suffering which we invite unnecessarily, unconsciously, the moment it is brought to your conscious awareness, it will disappear. Not only with parents and relatives I am talking, many ways you may be connected to your religious people, or your community people, your group of people, or your language people. You will have the common identity connections. Understand? Conditioning is one of the dangerous thing. If you are connected to the whole world, that is wonderful, you will never bring suffering for yourself. Because when you expand to the whole world without boundary, there is no ideology based connection. That does not belong to etheric, that belongs to cosmic body. Etheric body means emotion based connection, conditioning based connection. Conditioning based love, conditioning based connection will always lead to calamity, will always lead to danger, will always lead to violence. Because the other part, the part which you excluded, naturally you will be violent towards them. Naturally you will be violent, angry towards them. I have seen how the conditioning brings so much of suffering unconsciously to a person, and the suffering which he enjoys or cherishes creates more violence and suffering. Understand? Ego means working based on pain body and expanding the boundary of pain body is ego. If you are making some decisions because of the people whom you think is your own is suffering, all your decisions to alleviate their suffering will add only more suffering to the planet Earth. You may add suffering to somebody else, and that person naturally will add suffering to the group which you are thinking as your own. Say, eye for eye will only end up making the whole world blind. You will remove his eye and he will remove, as a revenge, one person from your party. And all you guys will remove now one person from their party. If continuously this goes on, where it will end? It will make the whole world blind, that's all. Ending place will be whole world blind. Mahadeva says, enter etheric presence, pervading far above. Understand? He knows, I think. People are going to live too far and have the etheric connection. That's why he does not say above, far above. And far below your form. Your form may be the center, but with whoever you feel connected emotionally, if some particular language people, or a religious people, or a relative, or community, anything condition based connection. Condition based connection. 10 days from morning till night, be aware of all of them as a part of your own body. Visualize you have a huge light body. Body of them are inside you as part. Maybe looking very funny, feeling very funny. You may think, how this can lead me to enlightenment? You do not know. You do not know with how many conditionings you are suffering in unconscious level. Only when you practice this, you will realize all the layers and layers of conditionings with which you are suffering unconsciously. They will all come up to consciousness. The moment they come up to the consciousness, naturally you will be unclutched from them. You will be relieved from them. You will be relaxed from them. Understand? The sutra is very powerful. May not directly now you may not feel how can this open enlightenment. Till you open the door, you will not be aware what is inside the building. I have seen so many people. When they come inside our temple, when they open the Vedic temple door, it's hardly 7 feet door. They never imagine anything. They can't imagine what is inside. The moment they open the door inside and second door and look inside, God, they get the shock, because psychologically you always feel inside you will see things only up based on the height of the entrance. If the entrance is 7 feet, inside also you already imagine or come to a pre-conclusion. Prejudice, you are going to see only the things which are taller, equivalent to the sight.
You never imagine, only when you see, suddenly you have the shock. God, what is this? How did it all come inside? How all these deities are there? The moment only they, when they see inside, they get the shock. That is why I just wanted to, I really wanted to name that place as a shock spot. The moment they open the eyes, oh God, it's such a shock. Till you see, you do not know what you are going to see with that key. Same way, till you practice for 10 days, you do not know how many layers of your own conditioning you are going to experience with this technique. You will see two big things, much more than what you expected. It is a very wonderful technique. The next sutra is a continuity. Actually, it is a same sutra. Only one small difference, technique, the difference in technique. Put mind stuff in such inexpressible fineness, above, below, and in your heart. Understand? The same technique. In first technique, Mahadeva says, experience the etheric presence above and below you. In the second technique, he says, it's actually a developed version. After you practice the first, you have to do second. You can't do second directly. He says, be aware of all the etheric connections you have. Means the etheric bodies, boundaries you have. Along with that, be aware of your boundary also. Here you need to put awareness in two places. Let me describe exactly what Mahadeva means. In the first sutra, he says, just put your awareness on mind, that is enough, I will automatically get dismantled. Because I has no individual base except the mind. The second he says, sometime you would have collected a very strong I, you don't even know the corruption, the depth of corruption which exists in that I. Beyond conditioning you may be having some ideas. So put your awareness on that also. Understand? Two different techniques. Maybe the second technique for real thick heads. Real thick heads. First technique is remember, be aware, expand to all the psychological, emotional, etheric connections which brings you suffering. I have seen many times. See, if you can stop accumulating etheric anger and etheric lust, that is enough, you are liberated. Because the anger or lust which you can contain in this body will never be harmful to you. Will never be harmful to you. I have seen people carrying the anger which directly is not involved to their life. If somebody is killed somewhere who is supposed to be the community in which he is born and brought up, here his blood will boil. When they read the news, let him suffer. I know he should have it. Sitting in front of TV, they will be shouting. Accumulating the anger more than what you need to run your day-to-day life is the danger. Accumulating the lust more than what you need to run your day-to-day life. Somebody, some celebrity is dancing in the TV. And already you accumulated the lust, which you can't directly use in your day-to-day life, which is useless. In your day-to-day life, that lust is not going to be useful. But you accumulated that lust. Naturally, that is going to stay inside you as a blockage. If you have the lust with the person with whom you are living, which you can directly express, means useful to your day-to-day life. Useful to your day-to-day life. Accumulate lust or anger useful to your day-to-day life, that will never be dangerous. That will never be dangerous. I tell you, it will only help you to run your day-to-day life with excitement. Somebody goes to a doctor and says, "Doctor, I want to live 100 years. What all should I do?" Doctor asks, "Do you drink?" He said, "No." "Do you smoke?" "No." "Do you fool around, date around?" He says, "No, I live a straight, simple, pure life." Then doctor asks, "Then why do you want to live 100 years? Understand? I'm not saying disconnect or destroy everything. Accumulate the anger which is needed only for your day-to-day life. You may need anger to run your business. You may need little shouting to maintain your office discipline. You may need little lust to have the to add excitement in your relationship. You may need little lust to keep the love or to keep the family going on. Have the lust, have the anger, have the emotions which are directly needed for your day-to-day life. Not etheric. Seeing some particular dimensioned male or female who are called models jumping somewhere, if you accumulate the lust which is not going to be directly straight away useful in your day-to-day life, you are creating blockages. You are creating disturbance in your etheric system. Understand? Be aware of even all those attachments. If you have your hero, if you are a fan of somebody, 15 days remember that person is part of your etheric body. Because all those things are also directly connected with whoever you are attached. Remember all those things as part of your body for 15 days. Suddenly you will see how much of suffering is added into your life by them. Not directly by them. Your emotional attachment to them. Your attachment to them. Same way, whoever you don't like, for no reason, you don't like somebody. Alright, you don't like, that is true. Your hatred, can it do anything to the person directly? No. It is not directly going to be useful in your day-to-day life. I have seen people sitting with the newspaper and reading the mortuary columns and feeling, this fellow, he needs this. As if you are never going to die. As if your photo is never going to appear in that mortuary column. Maybe it may not appear in the column in the newspaper, but it is not that you are not going to die. At least somebody has given an advertisement for him in the mortuary column. I have seen. Means vengeance which is not directly useful in the day-to-day life. Lust which is not directly useful in your day-to-day life. If you can accumulate the anger, lust, all the emotions which is directly needed for your everyday life and spend it, your life will be like that barber before finding the golden jar. It will be contented, fulfilled, wonderful. But the moment you find the golden jar and try to fulfill it, like collecting the anger and collecting the lust, collecting the violence which is not directly useful in your day-to-day life, which you can't spend. The big problem with that yaksha's jar, golden pot, is you will never feel like taking it out and spending. You will only feel like filling it. Same way, the collected anger and lust which is not directly useful in your life, you will never be able to spend it. You will be only accumulating it. And anybody who is working based on the accumulated anger and lust without reason, without the direct use, will continue to suffer, because all their decisions will be made on the
pseudo anger, pseudo lust, which is not directly useful in their life. Be aware, two technique, understand? Be aware, first 10 days, only about the etheric body. That itself will take your awareness. You will not be aware of you also. Just be aware of all the etheric connections and the body around the world, all your likes and dislikes, love and hatred, all the connections. Remember, everything is inside you as part of your body. Move with the same visualization for 10 days. You will see so many understandings and revelations and great spiritual clicks happening in you. So many initiations will open up. Second thing, second part, if in the first part itself, if you achieve the truth, then no need for second. Otherwise, the second part, be aware of you also, center also. Then, so many other things can happen. Put mind stuff in such inexpressible fineness above, below, and in your heart. That's the only word added. The key word added is and in your heart. That is the essence. Understand? Both techniques are today fortunately part of the same sutra, because I am seeing many of you are tired after attending two long days of workshop. So, I think Shiva knows maybe. After the 2 day workshop, the sutra is going to be taken. So he gave both the techniques in one sutra so that you don't have to sit for more time. I'll tell the essence in few lines. Visualize all the love, hatred, emotional relationships which you have in your life as part of your etheric body, means light body. Visualize you have a huge light body. If you have somebody who is really emotionally connected to you in India, visualize you have a huge body which extends up to India, and that person is inside that body. 10 days carry this visualization. Let all the emotional hatred or loving connections be inside your etheric body. And if you experience the ultimate click with this technique, go ahead with this. If not, the second thing add, along with that, be aware of your center also. Your center also. Then you will see the new layers of click opening up. So, let you, of course, tomorrow we have the last day of Shiva Sutra. So, welcome you all to be here tomorrow to enjoy the last day of Shiva Sutra here, because I'll be doing the remaining few sutras in the ashram, Indian ashram, I'll complete it. So, formally, the public lecture Shiva Sutra will be ending tomorrow. It took almost 2 years. I remember 2006, January, we started, and 2007, December, it took 2 years to comment on at least around 100 sutras. We'll be finishing the public discourses on Shiva Sutras tomorrow. I welcome you all. So, let these sutras be internalized by you and practiced by you. Let you all achieve and radiate the eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you. Shiva.